You mean the functionality?
Sorry? Yeah. So this is on, right? Yeah. So it's a great pleasure to introduce our speaker today at the Warren Lecture. I'll try and go talk quiet. And our speaker today is Fabio Reyes. I have already got a dispensation to mispronounce everything okay. As far as possible, so it's going to be a tough call for me. So Fabio Reyes, who comes, he's from the Institute of Physics at the Federal University of Fluminense, which is in Nitro, which is across the bay from Rio. And Fabio is very extensively published in the physics literature and in the kind of general area of statistical physics, I would say. And one of the things that he does is diffusion and fractals. That's the main reason he's here, because I'm interested in working with him in the infiltration problems I've been looking at recently. And he's an MTS visitor, so he's going to be here through Friday of next week. So if anyone wants to have an extended conversation with him, he can. And he's done lots of things, I think, which intersect with people in the department. So that's going to be very good. He also has done some work in reaction diffusion. And I use that as a way of advertising the seminar next week is going to be on reaction diffusion. I have another speaker that's coming. I haven't had a speaker at the seminar series for 30 years, and I have two in a row. So Deirdre Bolster from the University of Notre Dame is going to come next week. And one of the main things that Fabio works on is surface processes at the small scale, growth, roughness, etc. And that's what he's going to be talking about today. So I'm going to hand the floor over to Fabio. So.
Okay, Vaughan, thank you very much for the presentation, and also I thank the University of Minnesota, the department, for the invitation and support for me to be here. Maybe in some slides you see a confusion between English and Portuguese, like in the date of the first one, but if you have any question and any doubt, you may ask me during the presentation or at the end. I speak here about some works I did in the last 10 years on models of thin film growth. Most of them based on simulations, and some of them also using analytical methods like scaling approaches, which are not exactly like most analytical methods we use in statistical mechanics, but they are phenomenological methods to understand scaling problems. Then, this is the outline of the presentation. First, I will show some techniques for deposition of thin films, which are of our interest and of interest of my collaborators, the experimentalists' collaborators. And in this part, I will show also some models we worked with in these years. Then, after this first part, I will briefly introduce scaling concepts for the surface roughness, for surface roughening. And then show some simple deposition models, and then some applications, and at the end just briefly show my research interests in this field and all in other fields. Well, one of the most important methods for production of thin films is molecular beam epitaxy. It is used to produce many semiconductor devices and producing metal films with high crystallinity order. Basically, in a scheme of this technique, we have effusion cells where one or more materials are evaporated, and there is a flux towards the substrate. And then this is a picture, a scheme with the processes that we expect to take place in the substrate where the film is growing. Then there is deposition and adsorption at the substrate or adsorption in the deposit, and the atoms or molecules in this surface, they can move. Usually it's a random movement, an activated surface diffusion, so that the diffusion coefficient depends on temperature and also depends on the energy of interaction with the substrate, with the surface below the atom and with the neighbors. And so here there is an illustration of several energy barriers that appear in the surface. We may summarize this process as saying that atoms diffuse, aggregate to islands, and detach from islands. Then, in some models we worked with in the last year, mainly with Tiago Oliveira, one of my main co-workers, we studied submonolayer growth, which is the growth of islands when less than one layer of the material is completed. Then here is a diagram of of what we see when we increase the temperature or increase the coverage, theta. Then if we have low temperature, then we have branched islands, but increasing the temperature as the film grows, the islands become more compact. And in this study, we could confirm universal features proposed for the distribution of the size of capture zones. For understanding what is a capture zone, you imagine that an atom falls in the substrate at a certain point. There is one island which is the closest island to that point. So it means that that point belongs to the capture zone of that island. And then we studied the distribution of these capture zones, because working analytically with capture zones is a way, a suitable way to predict the island size distributions and the shape of the distributions. And with this confirmation, we are able to show, using a scaling approach, how is the tail of the island size distribution based on the universal capture zone distributions. So we can, so in this way, we can connect with these methods. Those pictures are obtained by kinetic Monte Carlo simulation. And then we are able to connect the microscopic events of the growth, like diffusion, aggregation, detachment, with the morphological properties of the islands in that case. Several of the works I've been doing in the last years with collaborators in Brazil and in France are on modeling electrodeposition. In electrodeposition, typically you have the three electrode setup like this one, and you have a difference of potential between cathode and anode. And in the cathode, there is growth of a film, because species in solution, ions in solution, they attach to the electrode, they are reduced at the cathode, and then they form a film. It may be a film of a semiconductor, of pure semiconductor, of pure metal, or it may be a film with different aggregated species. Depending on the application you are interested. And then the kinetics of this process is very different from MBE. It's much more complicated. Although this is a much cheaper method, the kinetics is much more complicated, because in the solution above the cathode, There is a diffusion layer with depleted concentration of the ions, and then a convection layer, and after that, in a larger distance, you have the bulk electrolyte with the normal concentration of the electrolyte. Then describing the, in order to describe the growth, we have to understand also how is the flux of material to the cathode, which is not a directed flux like in molecular beam epitaxy. Then we also have to understand these layers. But then, here I show an application I worked 10 years ago with the collaborators in France on the growth of zinc oxide deposits, modeling the growth of zinc oxide deposits with eosine I, which is a dye. It is interesting to incorporate this dye in the zinc oxide for production of solar cells. Well, they were interested at that time, but I think they did not reach a point in which those structures could have commercial interest. But they worked a lot on this type of problem. And here is an image of scanning microscopy, scanning electron microscopy, of the film of zinc oxide with these bumps. And in these cases, the fraction of the dye in the film is about 1 or 2%. It's a very small quantity. But it has a catalytic effect so that the growth of the film is faster when the dye is incorporated in a very small amount. And then what I did as a model for that process is something very simple. I assume that there is a solution. I work in a lattice, it's a lattice model with a solution in which I have two types of moving particles, randomly moving particles. A big one which represents the eosine E, and a small one which represents the zinc ions in the solution, is these small particles E. And then when they meet, when they touch, they are moving randomly in the solution. When they touch an aggregated eosine, it aggregates. If it touches an aggregated zinc, then it may aggregate with a probability P. Usually I worked with small values of P, meaning that the growth of the zinc oxide, in fact, when I do a simulation like this, when I make a model like this, transforming Z to Z aggregated, what I'm trying to represent in a single step is the adsorption of zinc ion in the surface, and then the reduction, because it gets an electron, is reduced, and it aggregates to oxygen in the solution. So, in fact, the reduction is not so simple, because it also reacts with oxygen, and there is a large amount of oxygen in the water, and then it forms zinc oxide. So it's a simplified way to represent this reaction. But then, if the zinc ion finds an aggregated eosine, then I assume that we suppose that there are more electrons available there, and then with a large probability, one, it forms the Za, which represents the zinc oxide. And I also represent surface diffusion of Za, so that after aggregation, it moves to the lowest position in a certain neighborhood, representing some time of surface tension. Then what I get with the simple model is a film like this, in which the gray background is the the ZA particles represent the zinc oxide, and these branches, these black branches, are the eosine in a very small concentration. Here it is 1 or 2%. Yeah, but it's branched, so they seem to dominate the structure. But they form something like a skeleton for the growth due to the catalytic effect. And then we see here that with this type of simple model, we are able to reproduce some features, some morphological features of those films. In that work, we also reproduced some results of the kinetics, but I do not have time to discuss them here. It's just to present, my aim is just to show to you how we are able to describe some morphological properties using these kinetic Monte Carlo methods, and eventually improved with scaling approaches. Then a current work I'm doing with that guys from France is a work in which we combine electrodeposition and surface diffusion. And in this model, I have one cation reaching the surface at each time. Then after reaching the surface, it has a mobility, so it can move to distant places. And I may change this surface mobility to represent small or higher temperature, to represent small or larger activation energy. Then what I get in this process is that that film grows with an initial compact layer, then there is a transition to a branched structure, to a porous structure. And the main aim of the paper we have already submitted is to understand, is to show, to predict what is the size of this compact layer. Because growth of this type of film with different, with layers of different porosities, it's interesting for producing multifunctional films in which the compact layer may have one function and the porous layer may have another function. For instance, in the porous layer, you may incorporate a dye for using a solar cell. That's the interest of this third collaborator of me, Hafed Taleb. And then in this model, if we look at the top view, then depending on the diffusion coefficient at the surface, we may have more branched trees like this, or more compact trees like some flowers like these ones. And they are very similar to the electrodeposit films of copper that were deposited by Hafed, Hafed Taleb. And then we were very surprised that we could, with a relatively simple model, describe features, describe a morphology that's very similar to what they observed in the laboratory. And then other works on electrodeposition, I will just introduce them here, were done in collaboration with André Paza from the University of Santa Catarina, which is in the south of Brazil. We model growth of films of Prussian blue and copper oxide deposited in different substrates. And our main aim is to understand the morphology of the film surface. Then, here are some AFM images showing, for instance, in the case of the Prussian blue films, the surface after 50 cycles and after 100 cycles. For the copper oxide films from A, B, C, and D, the thickness of the film is also increased. In both cases, we observe that the size of these facets is also increasing. And then, if we want to understand the microscopic processes that are taking place there from the morphology, we have to understand how these surface features grow. I'll just present here other method that is used for thin film deposition by another colleague, this one, Sucano Ferreira from the University of Viçosa, which is in the country, in Brazil, about, let's say, 300 miles from Rio, maybe 300 to 400 miles from Rio. And he works on deposition of several materials like cadmium telluride. In hot wall epitaxy, he has a flux of the reactants, and then here a substrate. In fact, the substrate is shown here horizontal, but it should be inclined for the reactants to absorb. And there is an exhaust here, and this region is heated so that it promotes diffusion, large diffusion lengths of the atoms in the surface. And here are also some AFM images, which are basic for our analysis of the surface. In 60 minutes and 240 minutes, and we see that there is an increase also in the size of these blocks that are formed in the film surface. And here, the size of the typical grains are illustrated here. So the red line is a typical grain for 60 minutes, and the black one, the larger one, for 240 minutes. Then, in order to understand the physical processes that govern the growth, we have to be able to separate the effects of these grains from the global effects of large length scale fluctuations. That is our main idea, and that's one of our problems of interest that I'm going to show you in this talk. I will briefly review what we do when we study surface roughening. Taking one of those images, or one of those AFM images, for instance, we have here in blue the film surface, and then we use a box of size R. We may change the value of R. R may be as small as the pixel size of the image, or it may be as large as the total size of the image, total size L. This image is, of course, divided in pixels. And then we use this box to scan the surface. And at each point of the box, we measure the roughness inside, which I call W. Of course, I also measure the squared roughness. Frequently, I am interested for connection with analytical results with the squared roughness, which is just the standard deviation of the heights inside that box, position or window position. And then the average roughness is obtained by averaging this value over the different box positions. And if you also measure the thickness of the film, in most cases, the growth is linear, so that the rate of growth is constant, but not in all cases. If we measure the roughness at each position, we are also able to measure the roughness distribution, which is the probability density of the roughness having a given value. Because in a surface like this, or in a surface like the, oops, in the previous ones, depending on the position that you put the box, you may have a smaller roughness or a larger roughness. For instance, there are some points here with large peaks. Then, typically in these points, or in points where you have a deep valley, then you have higher roughness. In other points, they are smoother, then you have a small roughness. So we obtain a distribution of roughness. And we'll show that roughness distribution is a very good quantity to determine the scaling of the basic scaling features of the surface, or of the growth process, of the microscopic growth process. Then, here are some examples for those films electrodeposited of copper oxide and Prussian blue films. So this picture shows the change, the variation of the roughness as a function of the box size. Here the box size is L. And then it's interesting to observe that typical values of the box size are between some nanometers to some micrometers. And the roughness, usually for those films, is in the range of nanometers, maybe some tens of nanometers in some cases. So it's a very small roughness if you compare with the size. But this roughness may affect several physical properties, and it may be good for us to understand what are the microscopic processes in dominating the growth. Then, what do we expect for the surface roughness scaling? Then, at short times, the surface has only a small roughness, because there is a small correlation of the fluctuations between different points. And we begin the growth with a flat surface. But after some time, the correlation of these fluctuations increase so that some bumps form at the surface. And these bumps may also be rough internally. Then the correlation length across the parallel to the substrate increases. And then we have two possibilities, normal roughening or anomalous roughening. In normal roughening, the roughness for small box sizes, it increases as a power law, but it increases as a power law in the same way for different times, so that the small length scale fluctuations here are reproduced here and are reproduced here. And then when you reach the correlation length, the roughness saturates, so that if you have a large box for scanning the surface, you may double the size of the box, but you see the same roughness. And in the anomalous scaling, then the local roughness measured in small length scales, it increases in time, so that the short length scale, short wavelength fluctuations, they increase in time. And then I show here some other simple models that we use for these processes, but I will not spend a long time with this. We may simulate simple growth processes with models like this, restricted solid-on-solid model, in which it is forbidden the formation of slopes larger than one in the surface. So I throw one particle randomly to the surface, like in a Tetris model, and then it attaches if the slope formed with the neighbors is 0 or 1. Otherwise, the aggregation trial is rejected. And here I show another model, which is called the family model. Family is the name, is the surname of the guy who introduced this model. And the kinetics is also simple. When the atom reaches the surface, it moves to the lowest neighbor, lowest height among the neighbors. If it has both neighbors with the same smaller height, it chooses each one of them with probability 1/2. And then there are also stochastic models, stochastic equations to describe thin film growth, to describe surface growth, not only for thin films, describe interface growth in the hydrodynamic limits. One of the most famous ones is the one of Kardar, Paris, and Zhang. It now has 30 years. It suggests that the local growth velocity, which is dT, it has a factor of surface tension, and then an additional contribution of the local slope, which affects, for instance, that model, the RSOS, that I showed to you, in which, depending on the slope, I accept or reject the aggregation, and also the external flux and a random noise, a Gaussian noise. And then, depending on the model, this equation may be the representation of that model in the continuum limit. And there are also equations suitable to represent models dominated by surface diffusion, like this one proposed by Villain, Lai, and Asarma about 30 years ago, 25 years ago. And these equations, they are useful to separate these models in groups that we call the universality classes. In each universality class, having a certain set of scaling exponents, like, for instance, this exponent alpha. I showed to you that if I measure the roughness as a function of box size, for small box sizes, it increases as a power law. This power law has an exponent alpha. This is called the roughness exponent. And the correlation length of this that characterizes the saturation, it increases in time. It increases in time in this form. Z is called the dynamical exponent. And the saturation value of the roughness, which is the roughness of the complete deposit, it also increases in time. That saturation roughness that I showed to you some slides before. The saturation roughness here increases in time, the total roughness. This defines the third exponent, beta. And these values of alpha, beta, and z, they are common for several different models because these different models have the same hydrodynamic description by one of those growth equations, so that each one of those growth equations has a certain set of exponents. Here I only listed the roughness and the dynamical exponent. The growth exponent may be obtained from those ones. Then, what is interesting in using why is it useful to find the universality class of a given process? If we know this class, then we know what are the dominant growth mechanisms. Then, then that's why many people search for scaling exponents in growth processes and use them to discriminate with what are the basic microscopic processes. But then there are problems in using these exponents. One of them was the focus of our discussion in some works in the last years. In several cases, people measure the roughness as a function of box size and sees one region, one initial region with a large exponent alpha 1 and then another region with a smaller exponent alpha 2. It looks like the system has two roughness exponents. Here is an example of growth of zinc oxide by spray pyrolysis of a group in France. We have alpha 1 equals 0.97, close to 1, and here is 0.16, a much smaller exponent. And then here results for gold films in which the first region has an exponent 0.83 and the other one 0.37. 0.37 is very close to the prediction of the KPZ equation. But then, what's the reason for this first stage? We showed what was the reason. If you have, for instance, a surface with blocks and valleys with square symmetry, like a checkerboard lattice, in which you have some parts with height h and other parts with height 0, then if you scan this lattice with boxes of several sizes, what you find is that the roughness for box size is smaller than the size of these blocks is proportional to R. So it gives the exponent alpha equal to 1, like in some experiments it's observed. Then we also made simulations with cubic grains and rounded grains using that RSOS deposition that I showed you, that simple model. Here is a cut of the surface. We do all the simulations in three dimensions. Only the illustration is 2D. And then what you observe is that depending on the grain being cubic or rounded, you may have different exponents here in the initial growth, but all them close to 1, here between 0.85 and 1. And then we also worked with other models similar to that. We deposited blocks of different sizes. There is a certain distribution of the size, and then they flow to the surface, and they aggregate at first contact. Then I form a surface like this. And then, again, I observe that there is an initial regime where the box size is smaller than the average grain size, the average block size. When the box size is smaller than that value, I have here a slope close to 1. But the second part has a slope 0.1. It's much smaller than the one expected for this type of process, because this type of process is also expected to be KPZ, and I get a much smaller exponent. So the conclusion is that the presence of these blocks, this grain effect, may have bad effects on the measurement of the roughness exponents. So it's good that we try other approaches to understand what is the universality class of the growth that are not only measuring roughness of or growth exponents. And then I will skip this part of the Prussian blue deposition, and I will go directly to the problem of copper oxide deposition. Here is a transmission energy, transmission electron image of the surface for growth in different, for growth of the copper oxide in different substrates. And in these cases, in one case we observe anomalous roughening, in the other case we observed a normal roughness, roughening. And for these problems, we obtain the exponent alpha close to 0.90. The figure is here for copper oxide. This initial region always has slope for the two cases near 0.5, near 0.9. So it is a grain effect. And the other exponents that we measured, they did not say anything relevant to us. They were not consistent with any known universality class. Then what we did to try to understand what are the microscopic processes dominating the roughening of the film, we studied the high distributions, so that these high distributions are measured relatively to the average height of the film. And then we made a histogram of these fluctuations. And what is more interesting, we measured roughness distributions in those boxes. Each box has a certain roughness. And then we make the histogram of these of the roughness distribution. And then we scale by the variance of the distribution for each window size. And we get a universal curve. And also here, but the accuracy of the height distribution is usually not so good. And we also measured in those boxes with, and we get a good data collapse, the distribution of maximal heights. In each box, we measure the maximal height, and then in the other one, also the maximal heights, and look at the distribution. Maximal heights always measured relatively to the average. And we also get here a good data collapse, and the black solid curves are obtained for the image equation. The image equation, I passed it directly some slides ago, it is the stochastic growth equation dominated by surface diffusion without the nonlinear term, the linear equation. So that, going then back to those distributions, this shows that although electrodeposition is a very complicated problem concerning the flux of material to the cathode, the roughening is dominated by surface diffusion of the adsorbed species, atoms or molecules. And this is something unexpected for electrodeposition. This is expected for molecular beam epitaxy, for hot wall epitaxy too. But for hot wall epitaxy, we do not observe this. Again, for hot wall epitaxy, we have the grain effect for alpha. We obtain beta very close to KPZ, but the other exponents are not close to KPZ. Then what is the class of that process? In that case, we get a very good collapse of high distributions, roughness distributions, and maximal height distributions with the KPZ curves, in which the growth is dominated by surface tension with the nonlinear term related to the local slope, which is, for this method, for this technique, not the most expected situation. But we showed here the KPZ scaling. What was interesting in this work is that it was the first work to show evidence of KPZ scaling from a large number of measurements not only of exponents, but also of distributions of these several quantities. And then here I list my research interests besides the growth of thin films and nanostructures, in which I use simulations, kinetic Monte Carlo simulations, and scaling approaches, and sometimes with some collaborators, some analytical methods, usually simple analytical methods, in other ones, more complex, like renormalization group. I have some coworkers that use them. And I also have been working on corrosion processes and diffusion in porous and disordered media, which is the case of my collaboration with Vaughan here, and some recent works on mineral dissolution and on weathering and soil formation. In this case, we use reactive transport models. It's a collaboration that I have in Penn State, where I'm going in 2 weeks. And then, well, it's on time, so I think I will not speak about growth of outer layer in mineral weathering, because the time got short. And thank you very much for your attention.
Great job, Fabio. Good for finishing on time. That gets you massive bonus points. Do you have any questions from the audience? Randall.
I'm always fascinated when I'll call them toy models. I was continually thinking about Tetris.
Yes.
reproduce the qualitative behavior that's measurable. But what I'm curious about is going the other direction, and that is the toy models to the atomic level simulations that I've seen in seminars previously, so that can you take the toy models and relate them back to what's happening at that scale?
You mean the...
In terms of energetics, for example.
The energetics. Yes, not in the case of these Tetris-like models, but in more... in models like the ones we used for these processes. Because in these processes, there is activated diffusion of the atoms that fall in the substrate. And this depends on temperature and on an activation energy. And when they glue to an island, the diffusion coefficient is reduced. So the diffusion coefficient will lead to detachment. And then how this is modeled? By an increase in the activation energy. And also the temperature plays a role. When one atom is in a terrace, then for moving down, there is an additional barrier. So we can incorporate all these barriers in these simulations.
Thank you. Okay. In your model, it seems that the two length scales, one is the grain size, one is the correlation length the plot. I wonder whether these two length scales are related. Whether these two length scales are related or they are totally independent length scales?
In the simplest models, they are independent. Mm-hmm. So that the correlation length is larger than the block size, because I'm simply modeling the position of the blocks and then correlations between the blocks. In the experiments, yes. What we think is that these two length scales are very close, so that you observe the first stage of growth of the roughness with an exponent that is typical of grains. The second stage is masked, or it may almost disappear, and then it goes to saturation. And that's why we have to try to understand the growth using other quantities.
And that means the intermediate asymptote will appear when the growth time becomes longer, because autogradient increases.
Yes, probably if those films could be grown with larger and larger thicknesses, yeah, then possibly you would see these two stages, and then possibly you would see separation between grain size and correlation length.
Okay. But thanks.
It's difficult to predict.
I see. Thanks.
I've seen very similar behavior with the snow surface as I was chatting with you, but I was curious. Sometimes we didn't see the KPC, so we only saw a kind of gentle approach in the saturation land scale. And in that case, I wonder. I always thought that there was an effect of the sticking rule that was not as rigorous as we thought. But it seems that also grain size, different grain size could mask it. Is there some kind of a rule or some kind of a guideline on how much the grain should vary to completely destroy the KPC scaling?
No, really. But typically in processes in which there is formation of porous deposits, we have problems in the second scaling, the second part. Formation of pores is typical of ballistic deposits. And then, for instance, for the case, for the case in which I have an RSOS deposition, which produces compact films, then I see the smooth transition and see the KPZ exponent. But then, when we simulate this growth by attachment of blocks, they form holes here. They form a porous deposit. So here I show only the interface. But there are pores inside. In this case, typically, we have problems in the second stage.
Is this due to the variability in size of the blocks?
No, it's an intrinsic problem of this type of model in which porous deposits are formed. It is an intrinsic problem in ballistic deposition. Ballistic deposition is that model in which the aggregation is by first contact. It may be lateral contact. Then you form holes. In that model, if you look without grains, if you measure the local roughness as a function of box size, you see an exponent. If the box size is not extremely large, you see an exponent that is different from KPZ. Then it seems to be an intrinsic problem of these processes in which there is formation of porous deposits. But this is only the only separation we could see in these models.
So when the particles
Yes, sticking at first touch.
But sticking at first touch, if you use the same size of particle, you will see KPC.
So for one.
You can talk later. There's one more question. It's an interesting discussion, though. But Santiago wants to ask a question. You make this the last one, I think.
I have a question about the qualitative features of your AFM images. Is Ostwald ripening type mechanisms, could they be responsible for the formation of larger features from smaller ones due to surface diffusion?
Possibly. Possibly there is the formation of these short-scale features they are probably related to surface diffusion. But then the long length scale features, they may also be affected by other processes. In the, those cases of KPZ, for having KPZ, this suggests that we have surface tension and some kind of some type of effect of slope, maybe between the grains.
I see. So can I have one quick follow-up? The correlation length that diverges. So is it fair to call that a critical point, thinking in terms of critical phenomena?
It's difficult to make a relation with critical phenomena because this is a non-equilibrium system. Mm-hmm. It's completely far from thermodynamic equilibrium. Mm-hmm. So some features of the of equilibrium critical phenomena, they appear in this type of problem, like the scaling. Mm-hmm. Then the ideas, for instance, of that the roughness has a scaling as a function of time and box size. Mm-hmm. Then the same the roughness may be written as a homogeneous generalized function of these parameters, like in critical phenomena. Mm-hmm. But interpreting these exponents as critical, I don't see this interpretation. Maybe someone can think about such interpretation, but I don't see this.
Thank you.
Okay.
So I have some questions, but I'm going to leave them for later on in the interest of time. And Fabio is here all of next week if people want to have further discussions. So let's thank him one more time for a great seminar.
Thank you.